Prof, al microfono spento.
Ok, grazie. Thanks a lot, sorry. Do you hear me now, yeah?
Yes.
Okay, so just one thing. Tomorrow I will not be able to arrive in time. I will certainly arrive after 11:30 because I have to give another lesson before. And so tomorrow I will not be here before 11:30, okay? Fine. So let's go back to where we were. So let me recall what we are doing. And what we are doing is to try to find a way to solve differential equations by expanding on a basis. Which basis? The basis of the eigenfunctions of the differential operator. So let me summarize what we discussed last time. The idea is that there is, as you know, a strong similarity between solving partial differential equations, in particular with boundary conditions, and linear algebra problems. So the problems in both cases can be reduced to something as an operator or a matrix, acting on something that we want to determine. In one case is a function, in the other case is a column of numbers, equal to something that instead we know that in one case is another function, a known function, and in the case of linear algebra is a known column of coefficients. And the crucial question is, in the case of linear algebra, we know that certain properties of the matrix are crucial. You have studied in the case of quantum mechanics, mainly Hermitian matrices. And in the problems that we are discussing, the matrices are real. So Hermitian transforms into symmetric. And so the question that we are addressing is if the differential operator that we are studying is symmetric or is not symmetric. Symmetric operator we defined last time is what is written here. So K is the operator and U and V are two functions that belong to its space. And therefore, this is a scalar product. The scalar product of F and G is just this integral. Here I put a complex conjugate just because I wanted to show what happens in case, I mean, we wanted to demonstrate that the eigenvalues for a symmetric matrix are real. But we don't need to put the complex conjugate because everything will be real in our problems. So this is what it means to have a symmetric operator. And as you recall, to decide if an operator is symmetric or is not symmetric, it is crucial to also impose the boundary conditions. So a certain operator can be symmetric under certain boundary conditions and not symmetric with different boundary conditions. You have seen this in quantum mechanics when you studied, for instance, the momentum operator and you considered boundary conditions periodic. In that case, it is an Hermitian operator. Or if instead you are considering boundary conditions in which the function, for instance, vanishes at two extremes, then it is not Hermitian. And similarly in our cases. So in general, when we are addressing one of the problems, we have to start by asking ourselves if the operator, the differential operator, is symmetric or not symmetric. If it is symmetric, then we have checked that there are those very important properties, that the eigenvalues are real, and that if we have two different eigenvalues, the corresponding eigenfunctions are orthogonal. So after what we can do is, for instance, to normalize the eigenfunctions so to generate a base, and we can expand everything essentially on that base. This is the general idea. So we arrived to discuss essentially one very simple case, which is the case in which we have differential operator, which is the second derivative, and we imposed as boundary conditions the Dirichlet boundary condition, meaning that the function solution of the differential equation has to vanish at the two extremes of the interval. So it was essentially this case here, u of 0 equal to 0, u of L equal to 0, and this means that in principle the eigenfunctions of this differential operator are a mix of sinus and cosinus, but after it has to vanish is in 0, so the cosinus does not work, so we have to take the sinus, and at that point we have to impose that the sinus vanishes at L, and this is what, as you know, fixes the eigenvalues, because we can write our eigenfunctions as proportional to sinus of theta L, but sinus of theta X, but then sinus of theta L has to be zero, therefore theta L is n times pi, and this is what forces the discretization of the eigenvalues. So at that point we have determined the eigenvalues and the eigenfunctions, and we can also normalize the eigenfunctions in the sense that we can compute the scalar product of one eigenfunction with itself, and in this case this scalar product is this integral of sine square and is always equal to L half. You recall the fact that the average value of the trigonometric functions sinus and cosinus, if they are averaged on an entire number of cycles, their average value is 1/2. So at that point you take 1/2 and you multiply by the integration range, which is L. Okay. So at this point we have everything, and we can go back to study our original problem. So original problem is something like this. So we are still facing another problem, so to say, in the sense that, okay, we have discussed the differential operator, and we know that this function sinus of blah blah constitute a basis. And in particular, this basis is made of functions which are all vanishing at zero and at L, which are the two boundary conditions of the problem. But what about the function f? Because the function f by itself is arbitrary. So does it make any sense to expand the function f on the basis of the sinus, because the function f could, for instance, not vanish at zero or at L. So let's elaborate a little on this problem, and I prepared a little numerical exercise that I want to show you. If I manage. Yeah, it's here. Oh, gosh. Wait a second. Just a second. Can you read over there? It's possible to see what is written. Yeah, okay. Okay, so these are two exercises of the book, exercise 5.5, 5.6. So, which is the purpose of these exercises? The idea is to check the following. Suppose that we have chosen as a base this base of sinus of blah blah. So we know that all these functions are vanishing at zero and at L. Okay, but f is a generic function. So the question is, what does it mean that we can also expand f on that base? So let let you use this also as a little exercise for Python that I is new for me and probably is also quite new for you. So how to do this? What I want to do is to try to expand a couple of examples of functions. So let's say that the interval we are discussing is the interval 0, 1, okay? And let's take two functions. This function here, x times 1 minus x, and just 1 minus x. So, clear enough, if we consider the first function, this is vanishing at x equal to 0 and at x equal to 1. So we can expand that, we can imagine that we have no problems in expanding this function using the sinus that we discussed before. The question will be, what about the function 1 minus x? Because this one for x equal to 0 is equal to 1 and not equal to 0. So let's try to do these expansions, and after we compare a certain truncation of expansion with the exact function, and we try to understand what is happening. So let me just remind you a few comments of Python. As I said, Python is new to me, and I imagine it's also quite new to you. So the first thing, is that in many cases, we are going to use this package, this numerical Python. It contains a lot of useful comments. So let's import this numpy. And instead of having to write every time numpy, let's call it np just for shorthand. And similarly, we will need a package that is one that is essentially dealing with making plots. And we will call this package plotter. So after this, you start by defining functions. And you see it's very easy. It's just def for defining, and you define these two objects. Let me just remind you a very important point. The very important point is the relevance of indentation inside Python. So here I want to define this function f1, and all what essentially will remain indented will correspond to part of a definition of f1 or part of a definition of f2. Also, this semicolon is very important because it tells explicitly Python, okay, from here forward comes the definition of F1 and F2. Okay. There are different ways after to write explicitly a function. This is the shortest. The shortest way is just to tell, okay, I want to define F1, and I directly write okay, x is the variable entering, and return, give back this object, similarly for this. You can write it a little bit more lengthy. For instance, you can introduce a variable and after tell that you return the value of that variable, but okay. If the function is this simple, there is no purpose to write something longer. Second point, we want to compute the Fourier components of F1 and F2, meaning that we want to project F1 and F2 on that basis, meaning that we have to integrate, in this case, from 0 to 1, F1 or F2 with each of the elements of the base. How to perform this integral? There are essentially two ways that you can try, at least two ways you can try inside Python, or three ways if you like. First of all, you have to decide if you want to perform your integration numerically or analytically. Python has a limited ability in doing analytic integrations, for instance. I think that later I will show you another example in which I will use explicitly some of these analytic abilities of Python, but they are rather limited. So it's interesting sometimes to check if the specific problem we are dealing with can be solved analytically inside Python. For instance, the example that I will show later has to do with the ability of solving analytically a simple differential equation. Okay, but as I said, okay, I told you many times, is limited. So in general, you will have to resort to some numerical integration. So numerical integration means that you have to use some of those techniques. I don't know if you have ever seen any of the typical techniques of integration, numerical integration. Did you see in any previous course any simple technique of numerical integration? I mean, the Simpson rule or the Gaussian rule or something like that. Any of you have seen these things? No? Okay. Maybe if you save some time, I will show you some simple techniques. But essentially, the techniques for numerical integration in one dimension are based on a very simple idea. I mean, I want to integrate a certain function f from A to B. And essentially what I have to do is to evaluate the value of that function on a certain number of points distributed between A and B. I think that I mentioned when we were discussing the Euler method for solving numerical differential equations, you recall I was discussing, okay, so we have to integrate between x and x plus delta x, f of x, and so we have to evaluate f somewhere in this interval, okay? So this is the typical problem. The typical problem is if you want to integrate on a finite interval between A and B, you have to choose where to evaluate your function. So there are several techniques. In certain cases, you distribute in a uniform way your points in between A and B, the points where you are evaluating your function. So if you start from A and you want to arrive at B, you decide that you want to use, I don't know, 100 points, and you divide your interval in 100 sub-steps, and after you evaluate the function on each of the points, etc. And this is sometimes efficient. As you can imagine, of course, the precision increases with the number of points, and also there are other little tricks that essentially exploit the fact if your function smooth or not smooth. If it is smooth, then you can improve on that. After, there is another technique. I want to mention this technique because it's very common, very famous, and very useful, that is called Gaussian integration, okay? Gauss, among many, many things that he did in his life, he also asked himself the following question. Suppose that I have a function and I want to integrate this function between A and B. And let's assume that the function is smooth, Okay, this is an important assumption in the technique of Gauss. The function needs to be smooth. Okay, if I have a smooth function to integrate between A and B, is there a way, a priori, to optimize where to put the points? And funny enough, there is this way. And the points are not at all distributed in a uniform way. And they are the solution, they are the zeros of a special function. Okay, I don't want to enter the real details, but the point is that the solution of the question, where should I put the points of integration, where the points where I evaluate the function, if I want to optimize the procedure, the solution, the answer to that question is that the points are not distributed uniformly. Okay, so these are the so-called Gaussian points. As I said, these points are zeros of a certain special function and can be found easily tabulated, or you can explicitly compute yourself, etc. The Gaussian integration, when you can use it, let me tell again, there is an hypothesis that the function you are integrating is smooth. If the function is not smooth, you cannot directly use the Gaussian integration. But if the function is smooth, the Gaussian integration is extremely efficient, extremely efficient. And in general, you don't need to evaluate the function more than typically the number of the Gaussian integration points are something like 8, 16, 32, 64. 64 would give you an incredibly high precision. In general, you don't need. In general, you get already a very decent approximation to your function just evaluating, I don't know, 16, 32 times. Okay, so it's an extremely powerful technique. So when you read Gaussian integration, keep in mind that it refers to that specific thing. So what can you do if you need to evaluate numerically an integral? First possibility is you write yourself one of these little routines. It's not difficult. It's worth trying once in the life just to see in concrete how you can do. Or you can use one of the many ready packages where one of these routines is implemented. So inside Python, there are little routines ready for numerical integration. And these routines are inside the scientific Python, SciP. So if you want to use these routines, you have, first of all, to take something from scientific Python, and I just used one of these routines for integration. This quad is here and is using what is using, I think is using a very trivial technique with probably equally spaced points, I suspect. Okay, using a technique from the Fortran library, QuadPack, etc. Okay. I mean, the integration that we are going to perform are very trivial, and so it doesn't matter so much which technique you are using, but keep in mind that there are many techniques for performing even just one-dimensional integrals. Okay, so this quad is one of the techniques, quadrature is one of the techniques. You can find this is taken as is written here from a technique that you can find is called QuadPack. You can find online. Okay. So essentially, this you have imported this quad. Okay. So what? How does it work? This quad is very simple. The basic command of quad is written here. So quad is the integral. Okay, and you have to give the function you want to integrate, which is written here. You have two extremes of integration, 0, 1 in this case. And something, this is very useful, because the function we are going to integrate, let's take these two functions that I'm going to discuss in a second again, they depend on two variables, okay? So obviously you have to tell on which of these two variables you want to integrate, and the other one will be just some sort of parameter, okay? And that you can do in this way. You call arguments, meaning essentially that these are parameters, and here n will be a parameter, in the sense that I'm integrating on x for a given value of n, okay? Final little comment, this bracket zero. This quad works rather nicely, and it does not only provide a number, it provides the estimate of the integral. It provides a number and an error. So it tells you that the answer is 3.1 plus or minus blah, 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 okay? Now for our little calculations, we don't really need the error, okay? And so this bracket zero, I mean, you can try yourself. If I don't put the bracket zero, the answer contains two numbers in a bracket, okay? And I want the first of the two numbers. Now recall that Python labels zero the first element. So if I want the first element of that little string containing two numbers, I have to put zero and not one. Okay, that's it. So let's go back here. So I have defined these two functions, f1 and f2. I can define something that I call base, which contains all these signs. Notice that I have used not just the command sinus, but the command numpy sinus. There are little advantages from what I understand in using this numpy sinus. We are going to use one of these advantages. Sinus is really defined inside Python, if I recall correctly. But after you are a little bit limited in its usage. If you use instead this numpy sinus, you can do a little trick that I'm going to do somewhere here, which is to vectorize the function. Keep in mind that, let's say, the numpy sinus is the sinus, but has some special abilities that the normal sinus defined inside the core of Python, that definition does not have. Okay, so this is the sinus function. Okay, it just used the numpy sinus because it can have some little advantages. Notice that there are two variables, and it's fine. So is n and is x. Another thing, I wanted to use pi, 3.14, blah, 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 blah. And pi and how is called the e. How is called e? There's a name that I already forgot, of course. You know, that constant, 2.71, there's a name. Nepper constant, isn't it? Nepper constant. They are defined numerically inside, again, numerical Python. So you don't need to write yourself a good approximation for this constant. Just check if the constant you need is present in the list of the things that are inside numerical Python. So NP pi means have a look inside numerical Python and find the numerical value of pi, okay? This one. After, as I said, quad, this routine for evaluating an integral, needs that you give explicitly a function, okay? So let's write this function that needs to be integrated, and the function is the product of this object or of this object times one of the elements of the base. I am going to project f1 or f2 on each of the elements of the base. So this is the function that I am going to integrate between 0 and 1. Okay. And this is done here, both for f1 and for f2. Okay. There is a very important point that I am going to comment and probably will see a few times also in the future. These integrals as you can imagine, can even be done analytically, because we are just integrating between 0 and 1 a very simple function, 1 minus x or x times 1 minus x multiplied by sinus. Okay, so it can be done. If we had a slightly better package for doing analytic integrals, we could use it, for instance, Mathematica Hedwig's package, but okay, I mean, we have to do is what we have. So you can evaluate easily, numerically, analytically, that integral. And what you get is something very funny that I brought here. So there is a difference between the behavior of the coefficients of the expansion of the first function. The first function, let me recall you, is x times 1 minus x. So it vanishes at 0 and at 1, while the second is not vanishing at 1. So the coefficients of the expansion of the first function, the one that is respecting the same boundary conditions as the base, they go rapidly to 0. They go to 0 as 1 over n cube. Okay, while the coefficients of F2, the one that is not respecting the boundary conditions, they go to zero much, much more slowly, as 1 over n. This is something that is very general. If you have a basis, and your basis corresponds to a certain set of functions, for instance, in this case, our functions are all vanishing at 0. Okay. The way in which the coefficients of expansions are behaving depends on comparing, so to say, the function you are expanding with the element of the base. In this specific case, the first case, they are both smooth. They are both having a smooth first derivative, okay? And that even a smooth second derivative, that matters, okay? But in the second case, in the case just 1 minus x, if I compare each of the elements of the base with 1 minus x, there is a jump in the sense that for x equal to 0, each of the functions of the base vanishes, but the original function is equal to 1. So in a sense, it's similar as having a discontinuity in the value of a function. I could be in a slightly less traumatic situation, okay, in which the discontinuity is not for the function, but for the first derivative. In that case, the coefficients would go to zero as 1 over n squared. So essentially, the better is the correspondence between the elements of the base and the function we are expanding, the faster is the convergence of the series. So in the first case, the correspondence is very nice. Both the elements of the base and the function are vanishing at 0 and 1. They are everywhere smooth. The first derivative is smooth. The coefficients go down very rapidly as 1 over n cube. In the second case, there is a sort of discontinuity in the sense that all the elements of the base vanishes at 0. The function instead remains equal to 1 at 0. We pay that for the fact that the convergence is much slower. It is just 1 over n. Now we are going to check these points in detail. Okay. Okay, so we arrived here. So at this point, we can just call this function of this function if we want to evaluate the Fourier coefficients of the expansion. Okay, next step is that if we have evaluated, so now we have defined the Fourier here and above, and at this point, we can build an approximation to F1 and F2 by using a finite number of elements of our base. So essentially, what does this mean? This approximation of F1 or for F2 is a function depending on x and corresponding to a certain number of elements in the expansion. I mean, numerically, I cannot go to infinity unless I do something very tricky. So I just take, I don't know, 10, 20 elements of the base, and I use that truncation as an approximation to the original function. How do I write this? For instance, I want to approximate with n terms my original function. I can do by adding together elements of a series. So each of the elements of the series will correspond to one of the elements of the base multiplied by the Fourier coefficients. Okay, so what I'm writing is that I'm approximating f of x with sum over n of cn sinus of n pi x, etc. Okay. It's written here. Notice there are a couple of things that are maybe if you've never tried to write a little a little numerical code is worth noticing. So how do I write a sum? I can write a sum using a loop. So for j, which is an index, in this range, between 1 and n plus 1, recall there is another tricky thing of Python. If you write range 1, n plus 1, you take the first, but the n plus 1 is not evaluated. So actually it means that it's taking n elements, not n plus 1. It's like that. So for j running in this range, what you systematically do is you take the previous value of your function and you add another of these terms. You have, of course, to initialize. You state at the very beginning that this approx f1 is initially zero, okay, there's nothing. And after you start by adding, recall plus equal means approx f1 is equal to approx f1 plus this object. It's a short end notation. If I write a plus equal 1, it means a is equal to a plus 1. Okay, I'm increasing by 1 the element. And that's it. This is the definition of this approximation of order n, similarly for the function f2. Okay, so now we want to try to understand what is happening. So I was very happy last night being able to produce all these nice plots. And so we want to produce some plots. What do we want to do? We want essentially to compare the exact f1 and f2 with the approximated f1 and f2. We already know what. I already mentioned that if you use f1, the coefficients of the expansion are going to zero very rapidly, as 1 over n cubed. So it means that the convergence of the truncated series to the function is going to be very good, okay, very rapid. So if we concentrate on f1, if I make a plot, I did, but after it was completely useless. If I make a plot where I plot f1 and an approximation taking the first 10 terms, they are just exactly on top of one of the other. I don't see anything. So in that case, it's better to plot, for instance, the difference between f1 and one of the approximations. So this is what I did. And let also here have a look to some little tricks in Python. So first of all, I want to make a plot. A plot in Python means that I have two lists of numbers. One list is corresponding, say, to the values of x. I want to show my function for a certain number of values of x. And the second list corresponds to the values of the function. Okay. And after, the command will be simple. Is written somewhere down here. Let me just show. Like here, sorry, okay. Plot, for instance, something like this, it means that you plot x that actually is a list of values of x, and this div blah blah blah, which is the list of values of your function. Okay, so the typical command for plotting is something like this. You plot first list contains the values of the x, the second list the values of the function. So what I have to do is to generate these two lists. And is what I'm doing here. I want to make a plot between 0 and 1, and I can choose how many points I want in my plot. I exaggerated, 200 points, why not? And here I use what I was telling before. I can vectorize my function. This vectorization is something quite handy and corresponds to this. So I have this function approx f1. So what is approx f1? Let me remind you. Approx f1 is the truncation of a Fourier expansion of f1. Okay, so it depends on x and also on n, so to say, the order of the truncation. And now I want to evaluate this function, not just in one point, but on a list of values of points, all the points inside this list X, okay? So I can do this very, very rapidly by vectorizing the function. So this is a little bit funny in a sense. You tell Python, okay, I had the function approx F1, now transform that object into a vectorized object so that after I can pass as arguments not just one number for x and one number for n, but a list of numbers for x and in principle a list of numbers for n. And this will be done just with one comment, so to say, after. The advantage is that you don't have to write something which is extremely long and boring and easily done in a wrong way, the loops. I mean, every time that you have to write loops, it's tricky. So if you can avoid having too many loops, it's much better. If you just can deal with a string of numbers with just one comment, skipping the loops is much, much, much better. So that's why this vectorize is very handy. It tells, okay, take that function approx F1, that in principle depend on X and N, and vectorize, meaning that now the two arguments can be not just a number, but a list of numbers. So I do this for approx F1, approx F2, and also not for the exact F1 and the exact F2. Okay, so after I can make plot also of the exact object here. And at this point, I have to be very concrete. So I want to make a certain number of plots just to see what happens. For instance, I want to make plots in which I take the first 10 or 20 or 40 or 80 terms in this expansion. Okay. And notice that X is defined here. X is defined here. Okay. So X contains all these 200 points on which I am evaluating my object. Okay. And so this vectorized approximation, if I write x, this is the smart thing, if I write x, x is not a number, but a list of numbers. And it means essentially that it takes this object here, so it evaluates the approximation in all the 200 points. And so what is giving back this F1 10 corresponds not to a number, but to a list of numbers where I have evaluated approx F1 in each of the values of X. Is it clear enough what I'm saying or not? Even though I cannot see you, but let me see. Is it okay what I'm saying? Okay.
Prof?
Yeah.
Io in realtà non ho capito granché. Sì. Sì. Come mai qui abbiamo 10, 20, 40, 80? Nel senso, quello che ci restituisce sono tutti i valori rispetto a quella lista di X o sono tipo 10 valori?
Ok, good point. So we have two different numbers. We have a number of values of x that I have chosen to be 200, it is always 200. So x contains always these 200 numbers, okay? And it's always x. Instead, this 10, you recall that this function is a function of two variables. If you go back, approx f1, this is vectorized version, but is the vectorized version of approx f1, and approx f1 depends of x and n. So now, as x, I am passing not a number, but a list of numbers. While as n, as you recall, limits the number of elements that I am considering in this expansion. So I am taking the first n elements. So if I write approx f1 x 10, it means x is what it is x, that is always a list of 200 numbers. While 10 tells take an approximation with the first 10 elements in the base.
Okay. Is more, is more yes. Clear? Okay. Yes, it is. Thank you.
Okay. So this I've done for 10, 20, 40, 80, and I have compared with the exact. So all these are each of these objects is 200 numbers. Okay. And exactly the same for F2. But as I said, if I just compare the exact F1 with a truncation, the approximation is too good, I would see no difference for F1. For F2, instead, I see very easily the difference. We are going to look at it, okay? So let's define instead the difference between one of these objects and the exact value. Notice here, okay, there are several ways. I have chosen one specific way of writing this difference. So first of all, it's funny, you can just write F1 exact minus F1 10. F1 exact contains the 200 values of F1 on the 200 points of X. While F1 10 contains the 200 points of this approximation, okay, where I'm taking 10 terms in the series. And these two lists, each of the two lists contains 200 numbers, so I can just tell minus, and is subtracting each of the elements of the list from the corresponding element of the other list. Again, I don't need to write any loop. So let me tell again, the big advantage of when it's possible to go into these vectorized objects is that after you write A minus B, and not for all I from 1 to N, take AI minus BI, okay? That becomes just A minus B, okay? So I've done A minus B, and after to plot, I decided that the best way of plotting was to take the absolute value. Notice NP ups is the absolute value, okay? Because the difference between the exact and this can be positive or negative. And after take the log 10 of this difference. So this I've done here. So at that point, we are ready to plot. And this is what I've done essentially here. I must admit that I don't recall exactly why I put this extra command here. I think that this extra command has to do with using probably a smooth line or dashed line. I don't recall very well. You must check in the help of plot. Sorry, I forgot what it means. This I used it because I had already an example, but I forgot the purpose. Label instead is obvious. Label, put a label. Okay. And so at the very end, you just plot everything, the axis, the X, the Y, the legend, and you show what you're getting. So let's see some result. Okay. It's visible, isn't it? Can you see this graph? It's readable. So I was quite happy to produce this very fancy graph. So approximate 10, this recall is the logarithm, logarithm base 10, of the absolute value of the difference between the exact function and the approximation. Approximation with 10 terms, 20, 40, 80. So you see that already with 10 terms, the difference is smaller than 10 to minus 3. Okay, and it goes down very rapidly, going from 10 to 20, 40, 80. So if the function that I am approximating satisfies the same boundary conditions as the base, and it is as smooth as the base, the convergence is very fast. What happens in the other case? So the other case is totally similar, but this time I'm not really plotting the differences because it is visible, the difference between F1 and the approximant. So this is the first comparison. The orange line is the exact function y minus x, and this blue curve is what I get if I take 10 terms in my approximation. So we can see that there is an area, a region here, where the two curves are relatively similar, but of course the blue one goes to zero and the orange goes to one. And what happens if I increase the number of points? So this is 20, this is 40, this is 80. So it is clear that I am improving the agreement between the approximation and the function in the area where the function is smooth, the first derivative is smooth, they are both going to zero at one, but there is an increasing error for x approaching one, and moreover, the error at x equal to one is always exactly equal to, sorry, at x equal to zero is always exactly equal to one. So this means essentially that there is not a point like convergence, in the sense that if I choose x equal to zero, there is no convergence at all. On the other hand, if I decide to define the discrepancy between the function and the approximation by taking some integral, so to say, of the difference between the function and the approximation, so the difference is a function of x, and I can, why not, integrate on x from 0 to 1. That difference goes to 0 with increasing n, because what happens when n is rather large? That the difference is very small almost everywhere, and essentially there will be just one point where the difference is 1. But as you recall from Lebesgue integrals or whatever, that does not affect the result of the integral. It will be zero in the limit of n going to infinity. So this is an example in which the function f does not satisfy the same boundary conditions. So the Fourier expansion converges, but converges only, let's say, on average, not point-like. Okay. We will see that it's not a big problem when we use this expansion to solve our differential equation. Okay, so this was a first exercise, and before going to a second exercise, I have to write something, I think. Okay, so this I told. Just a second. I produced that thing, Google Class, this was called, okay, and I put the first exercise that you have seen a few lessons ago is already there, and I will now put the exercise of today also there. So if you enter that class, now I completely forgot, how do you do to enter the class? You have to know a number, no? That I gave you the number. It's correct, no, what I'm saying. Okay, so I will put systematically all the exercises there, and And I think you can also, in principle, send me things if I understand correctly. Anyway, so let me just spend a few words on telling something that, of course, we know, that we can generalize this technique. Here we have just considered the case of, just a second. Right. Okay. So what I wanted to say is that we can generalize this technique. Here we consider the example in which we have two Dirichlet boundary conditions telling that the function, the U, has to vanish at zero and at L. But another example that you can find on the book, and we'll not discuss in detail because it's very trivial, is, for instance, let's say, what happens if you have the same differential operator, but you impose again that U of zero is equal to zero, but this time instead you impose a Neumann boundary condition, the U over the X evaluated at X equal to L is equal to zero. So if you think a moment, it is clear that the first condition tells us that we have something as a sinus of theta x, theta x plus phi, so sinus of theta x plus phi. And after we have to impose the second boundary condition, and you end up with something of a form sinus of the phi is zero because the phi is zero because it has to vanish at zero. Okay. Okay. So it's sinus of theta x. You have to impose the second boundary condition, so the derivative has to be zero. So it has to be zero essentially the cosinus of theta x. And if you impose that, you get your functions, your base, your phi n. I don't do the calculation; it's too trivial. Is 2n minus 1 pi x divided by 2l for n, of course, equal to 1, 2, 3, etc. So this is what happens if you, instead of using the Dirichlet, use this sort of mixed boundary conditions. Okay, and of course you have to check that the differential operator is symmetric also under this mixed boundary conditions. Okay, so it's, the way of checking is exactly the same as we did last time. You start by writing KU comma V, and after you perform a double partial integration and you check that it corresponds to U comma KV. And this is true because you are imposing again this boundary condition. And so these are the eigenfunctions, and the corresponding eigenvalues are lambda n equal to 2n minus 1 square pi square divided by 4l square. Okay, again, n equal 1, 2. So you can expand everything also if you have this type of boundary conditions, and I don't think it's needed to spend time on this. And instead, let's now go to one example in which we are using this technique to solve some differential equation. So the idea is that let's start again from something as let's put this T. I want to have this T. Want to have the T, or we don't want to have the T. So a second. It has the T everywhere. So suppose that we are solving some differential equation of the form minus T du over dx equal to f of x with the Dirichlet boundary conditions u0 equal to 0 and ul equal to 0. Okay. So how do you proceed? So the first step is the one that we already discussed. You have to check if your differential operator, t is a constant, okay? If your differential operator is symmetric when you impose the boundary conditions. So in this case, you can check it's a symmetric operator, the eigenvalues are real, and the eigenfunctions corresponding to the different eigenvalues are orthogonal. We can normalize, we can build a base, we can expand everything on that base. At that point, of course, you are in a sense, you have two possibilities. Possibility number one is that f of x itself can be expanded exactly on the base, in the sense that suppose for simplicity that f of x just can be expanded as a containing a finite number of elements of the base. Can happen, of course. So if f of x contains an exact number, if f of x, suppose, of course it's a very special case, if f of x is really something as, let's say, sum on, let me call this cn, sum of n, of cn are the coefficients of the expansion of this f, of sinus of n pi x over n, and suppose that this is really something like this, okay, where n is a number, okay, suppose, then the equation can be solved exactly as you can imagine, because what you do, of course, is to expand also the u, so you write your u of x, and you expand exactly in the same way. You write this as a sum from 1 to n of certain coefficients that you need to determine of the same object, sinus of n pi x over n. So the point, of course, is that we know that these sinus functions are eigenfunctions of the differential operator. So if we act with our minus t second derivative of u over dx, the operator is linear, of course, and each of these sinus function is an eigenfunction of the differential operator with a specific eigenvalue. The eigenvalue in this case was lambda n was, I think, lambda n was n square pi squared divided by L squared. So this means essentially, let me write it here, that minus t, let's call this object here where our phi n, no? This object here where was our base, phi n. So minus t phi n second, okay, just is equal to lambda n phi n. Okay. So if I expand this object here, what I am getting is, of course, a sum from 1 to n. And what I have is just lambda n bn phi n. Okay, this is also, of course, phi n. So, I can solve exactly the equation because I have something of the form of that sum from 1 to n of lambda n bn phi n is equal to a sum from 1 to n of Cn by n. So the solution is what? We just have to recall that the eigenfunctions are orthogonal for different values of n. So I can just project on each of them, and therefore this transforms in telling that lambda n bn is equal to cn. So cn is known because it's the expansion of my function, lambda n is known, I just get bn. Bn is equal to cn over lambda n, and at that point everything is fixed because I know exactly the expansion of the solution on that base. The expansion will contain also exactly big N numbers because all the other Cn are zero. Okay. So if we are in the lucky case in which F just contains a finite number of terms of the basis, can be expanded of the basis and even contains a finite number, we are happy, we can solve the problem exactly. Of course, this is not the general case. The general case, F needs to be expanded in principle on infinite terms. Consider what we did a moment ago. And not only, but as we have seen a moment ago, F of x could not satisfy the same boundary conditions, and therefore the convergence of the series of the expansion of F of x could be not extremely good. What about the convergence instead of the solution? The solution is instead converging very nicely. Why? Well, because the solution is a function satisfying the same boundary conditions that the base is imposing. This is exactly what we did from the very beginning. Therefore, there is no mismatch. So the solution will, in general, converge nicely, even for the expansion of F can be not so satisfying. The series corresponding to the expansion of F maybe converges only on the average and rather slowly. But the solution, which satisfies the same boundary conditions of the problem, of course, that and of the base, that converges very nicely. So let me, at this point, show another example. Yeah. So, and after I will put these two examples online. Now let me just dunque file open 5.10. Okay, let me close this a second instead is messy. Okay, so this is a little other example of usage of this Fourier expansion using Python. Okay. So the problem that we are discussing, I could write this, anyway, is a problem 5.10. It's probably written, it's the name of the file is example 5.10, okay. And the problem corresponds exactly to that same differential operator we are discussing, minus t second derivative. And as a function, we get just a constant, the force of gravity. Okay, minus rho g. You understand what I'm saying. I mean, the differential equation is minus t second derivative of u equal to which function? Just a constant, let's say minus rho g, that corresponds to the force of gravity on a certain object. Okay, and the boundary conditions are Dirichlet, as before. So zero and zero at the two extremes. So this corresponds to having a string which is attached at the two extremes, and there is a force of gravity pulling down. and we want to, for a moment, this is time independent. From next week, we'll start discussing time-dependent problems, so we see how to make it oscillate. For the moment, we just try to solve a static problem. Okay. First point, Python can solve this specific simple differential equation analytically. This is one of the examples that I could find of ability of solving analytically something using Python. So let me show you. This is a package that we are not going to use enormously. And I am a little bit skeptical, so to say, of how much of it we can use. But it's worth keeping in mind that it exists, at least. From time to time, we can try to use it if possible. So this package is called Symbolic Python, SymP, Symbolic Python. And is the package that in principle contains, as I said, little codes for doing analytic calculations, not numerical calculation. So from this Symbolic Python, the first thing, which is a little bit funny, but you have to tell explicitly this Symbolic Python, the certain objects are variables that it has to deal with, so to say, analytically. So we will have X, T, R, G, L, and these are, so to say, variables, and we have to tell explicitly the code which are the variables it will have to deal with. Okay. I must admit, I have not yet fully understood how this little package works, so I've used it. It seems to work, but I've not yet fully understood all the logic behind Symbolic Python. The other two packages are the one that you always load, Numerical Python, and the package for making plots. Okay, but let's first use this Symbolic Python. And okay, so you can solve explicitly this differential equation using dsolve. So in dsolve, what you have to write is first of all the differential equation. The differential equation is written in a funny way, with this comment EQ. So EQ is a comment that tells that there is an equality between two objects. So if you look carefully, you see that there is EQ, a bracket. Inside the bracket, there are two objects separated by a comma. The first object is T, which is just a parameter. The second derivative of f, okay, so it is indicated as derivative of x, comma, comma, meaning that is the second derivative of f. These are commas which are specific of this Symbolic Python, okay. This dissolve in particular is specific of this Symbolic Python. Okay, so what I have written here is a t second derivative of f. And what is f? F is a function. Notice that is a completely different animal respect to what we had before, that was define function f of x and blah, blah, blah. This is a function inside the Symbolic Python. Okay, so we want to determine this function. That's the point. So we are passing Symbolic Python the information that f will be a function, that we have, first of all, an identity. This is EQ, an equality between two objects. The object that is the first part inside EQ, which is t second derivative of that function, and the second object, which is the product of the two constants, which are the density and the force of gravity. Okay. After you have to tell symbolic Python that you want to solve analytically with dissolve this thing that corresponds to having it equal the first and the second term, okay? What you want to get is the function f of x. And funny enough, even for this is something that I don't understand is rather new, because if I understand correctly, slightly older versions of this SymPy could not deal with. So they are improving on it. Maybe in a few years before I retire, will be perfectly working. Okay. And this x is initial conditions. These initial conditions are that f at 0 is 0 and f at l is 0. So if you look online, you will find some strange comment telling that it's not obvious that dissolve really works using x, etc. But actually it seems to work. And I have a feeling that is something that we have introduced rather recently. So the old comments are still telling you cannot, but it seems to work. And that's it. Essentially, what you do after is to tell Python that you want to have a look at what it did, so to print what is this solution. Okay. So let's first of all have a look at that. Just a second. I want to run this. Run. So if I run it, assuming that everything was fine, voila, okay. Let's concentrate and forget for a moment the graph. Just look at this object here. So this, oh gosh, this is the result. The result is another equality. You recall this EQ tells the first and the second term are identical, okay? So f of x is identical to this object here, which is really the solution, funny enough, is correct. Okay, so this is really the exact analytical solution of that differential equation with the two boundary conditions. It contains a term which is linear in x and a term which is quadratic, and that's it. So it vanishes both at zero, and if you check, it vanishes also at x equal to l. Okay. And that's it. So this is what I did for the moment concerning the usage of this symbolic Python. If you like, you can also have a look at it. It would be nice if we could use it more. But for instance, something that I have not yet been able, maybe it's possible, maybe it's just me that I have not yet been able, is, for instance, I would like very much to evaluate certain integrals analytically. And to, for instance, before we were computing the Fourier coefficients, which depend, of course, on n, the n entering the element of the base. So I would like very much to be able to evaluate an integral of, let's say, f of x multiplied by sinus of n pi x over l, and to get as an answer an object containing n, you know, as a parameter, in a sense. I have not yet been able. Maybe it's possible, maybe you can try. If you try and you succeed, you tell me, and you immediately get two extra points for the exam. Okay, so you start from, not from zero, but from two. It's already a big jump, I mean. But I have not yet been able. Okay, so it's limited for the moment. The ability, my ability at least, of using SymPy is still very limited. Anyway, what we got is the exact solution. So this is good, because after we can compare what we are getting with the exact solution. Okay, so let's see what after. Okay, so up to here, since this was analytic, I had not to give explicit numbers, explicit values for G, rho, and blah, blah. But if I want to do numerical calculations, I have to tell. So these are the numbers, 980 centimeter square, second square, and rho is a density, L is a length, and T is a tension. Okay. Are the numbers that were on the book. Okay. And okay, the next thing is that we want, as usual, to plot everything on a plot. So we will need again X that will be again 200 numbers between 0 and L. And So I used already the analytic solution, this minus GL, rho X, etc., because I wanted to use it to compare at the very end with the approximate solution. So I defined the function fun that is exactly, this is the exact solution, okay? So fun of X is the exact solution, okay? And since I will want to plot it, I also here introduced that idea of vectorizing, so that instead of having X as a number, I can have X as a list of 200 numbers. So if after I write, so V fun is vectorized fun, and if I write Y equal V fun of X, Y contains 200 numbers. Okay, so what I have done here is just to plot the exact solution, which is this one. Okay, so this is what happens if you have your string that is fixed at 0 and at L, and you have a force of gravity pulling a little bit down. Okay. Now, let's see how to deal with it using the technique that we have discussed. So exactly as before, we need to project the right-hand side of the equation, that in our case is just a constant, on the base. And so the base is this, I wrote this a couple of weeks ago, so the notation is slightly different respect to the one that I did last night. So I did not introduce a base, but okay. The base is sinus of n pi x, so this is what the sinus is, the base. And so what I have to do is to compute, first of all, the product of the element of the base times the right-hand side, the known function, which is just minus rg. And after I will integrate between 0 and L, that I do again using that quad routine that we have seen before. So I have a function fun1, I integrate between 0 and L, and here I can tell that, again, n is a parameter, so don't touch it. And I take just the first element because I'm not interested in the error bar. And since I am doing something a little bit silly, I had a constant, and I am expanding the constant, not vanishing constant, on a base of objects that are vanishing at 0 and at L. So I cannot expand that the convergence is exceptional. Okay. But the solution will instead converge very rapidly. Okay. That's the point. It's badly written. Sorry, I will have to write it better. So the comment, I wrote it too rapidly. The comment wanted to tell that the expansion of a constant on the base is certainly not exceptional, but the expansion of the solution will be fine. Okay, we have to correct this comment that I wrote. Okay. What else? Okay, here you recall I wrote a moment ago that the relation between the coefficients of expansion of the function f and the coefficients of expansion of the solution are simply related if we know the eigenvalues. If you recall, let me see a moment, it must have still written here. here. So the coefficients of expansion of a function f I called cn, the coefficient of expansion of a solution I called bn, bn is what I want to determine. I know the eigenvalues lambda n, so bn is cn divided by lambda n. That is what I am doing, I'm doing here. So essentially what I am doing is that I take the Fourier CN, these are the coefficients of expansion, and I divide by the eigenvalues, if I have done it correctly, and these are the coefficients of expansion of the solution. So that point again, I have to expand my solution. Forget, I put a number of comments that probably are not properly written. I will clean it up and put on the web after, okay? Okay, so this was the right-hand side, that was just a constant. And we can check how badly the right-hand side is approximated if I take 10 or 50 elements. Let's see if I've done it really. Oops. There is still a little bit. Okay. So you see, this is just to show how badly, in a sense, this expansion works for the right-hand side. The right-hand side is a constant, is the green line. And depending if you take 10 terms or 50 terms, you see what you are getting. And definitively, I mean, of course, there is a jump at the two extremes. Okay. But after we do the same for the solution. So here, essentially, we proceed exactly as before. We define, this x is always 200 points. Oops. We vectorize the approximation with 10 terms or 50 terms. Is this approx 10 terms, approx 50 terms, and after we have the vec approx, that so that we can pass as x the list of 200 points. And this finishes in y10 and y50. So y10 and y50 are the 200 values of the approximation with 10 terms, the 200 terms of the approximation with 50 terms. And I think that, Z instead was the vectorized form of the right-hand side. Okay. That's what I already used, actually. So, and we plot, essentially we plot. Okay, there's no big mystery. In the sense that, so these are the coefficients, and I have a solution which is obtained. The expansions of the right hand side is horrible, as we see here. So even with 50 terms, it's not so nice. What about the solution? The solution instead is works magically, because even just taking 4 terms, you get a fantastically good solution. What I have shown somewhere. Yeah. Okay. So here, exact is the green. You can distinguish the blue, that contains actually only 2 terms, but you cannot distinguish the orange that contains 4 terms. And I think that I plotted probably the difference. Yeah, so this is the difference between the exact and the one with 2 terms and 4 terms. So you see that with 4 terms, you're already down to something of the order of 10 to minus 3 as a difference. Okay. I think that's it essentially. The rest is just the usual thing. Was it okay? Could you follow more or less? Some of the comments are not correct because I brought, I was doing it and it's not been complete. So. Questions from home? Just remind you, I will be certainly not here before 11:30 tomorrow because I have to give another lesson. And so that's it. No questions? Everything is okay?
Yeah, it's okay. Thank you.
Okay, then. See you tomorrow. Ciao.
See you. Thank you.
Arrivederci.
Ciao. Arrivederci. Ciao.
Allora, dunque, questo lo chiudo. Devo andare qua. Allora. Dunque, sto sharing e devo anche fare top recording.